keeping of the law, not with trying to be good, but with the precious blood of Jesus. If there's anything that is priceless, if there's anything that you can't even begin to describe the worth and the value of, it's the shed blood of Christ. Now the life of Jesus, now we believe in the pre-incarnate Christ. We believe Jesus existed before the baby in Bethlehem. Jesus said himself, before Abraham was, I am. But then there came the incarnation. Here's the life of Christ. Born of the Virgin Mary. Lived a sinless life. Performed miracles. Was crucified. Rose again. His physical ascension to heaven. And there's a seventh component, his exaltation, whereby he was seated at the right hand, Justin said it this morning, he was seated at the right hand of God on high, where he ever liveth to make intercession for us. And the book of Hebrews says that the blood of Jesus speaks better things than the blood of Abel. What did Abel's blood cry out for? Vengeance! But the blood of Jesus cries out for mercy. You see, you read the book of Hebrews, it says he took his blood and he sprinkled upon the true mercy seat in heaven before the throne of God. And continually, constantly before the throne of God, before the eyes of God, what does he see in that mercy seat? The redemptive blood of his Son that purchased us back from the slavery of sin. Ah, this gift, it's the gift of a redeemer. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed. I'm redeemed. I'm purchased. You're purchased. When you think of that gift that he gave, you have to think of the gift of the redeemer. And we also see the gift of Jesus, the life giver. Jesus said, I am come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly. The wages of sin is death. What's the rest of that scripture? But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Savior. You were dead in your trespasses and sins. We're going to read that scripture in just a moment. But in John chapter 3, verse 36, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. He that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. Salvation, if we're going to talk theologically about salvation, we can sum salvation up in three things. Sanctification, justification, and regeneration. Regeneration is the life-giving and quickening part of the salvation. Regeneration yields life eternal. But ye who were, this is Ephesians, ye who were dead in your trespasses and sins, hath ye quickened. It's also Colossians 2 says the same thing. Ye who were dead in your trespasses and sins. Go back to where we started from. In Genesis, we talked about death. You die and you shall die. You're spiritually dead. Why is it there's people in the world that don't understand or see or perceive or grasp a hold of this thing about Jesus? They're dead. They're spiritually dead. I was watching a show yesterday, Aerial America. I keep waiting for the show in Pennsylvania. I just have a vision, you know, it's where they show a state of the union and they have all these aerial pictures and all the topography and all the great things of the state. And I keep hoping they'll show Loyalton. That's what they get over in Pennsylvania. And here's Loyalton, Pennsylvania. What a beautiful little hamlet that is. With a ball field. And what else do we have in Loyalton?
A red light.
A red light. and a convenience store, several members of this church, the football field, Littleton, and so does Pastor. So you know, it has to be a wonderful place. But they were showing Arizona, and they were showing a place, I can't remember what it was, I told you. If I would have seen that show 50 years ago, I could have told you verbatim what it they said. But they were saying it's such a spiritual experience for people. No, that's spiritual in a small S. It's not spiritual in a capital S. Because only the regenerative power of Christ can do that. Now, let me be clear about this. For those of you who have been blood washed, saved by the power of Jesus, right now inside of you abides eternal life. You're not going to get eternal life. You already have it because Jesus is in you. So that you can pass from this life unto the next. In my Father's house are many mansions. If this were not so, I would have told you so. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. Why? So that where I am, there ye may be also. I told you I'm not wild about death, but I know this. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For he is with me. Where is he? Is he beside me? No. Is he hovering over me? No. Is he behind me? Pushing me? No. I like these people when my mother died, people said, we need to read Oprah Winfrey's book. I read Oprah Winfrey. You know, this book, Oprah Winfrey, is called Embraced by the Light She Was Pushing. The book is not biblical. It's not. To me, I'm not concerned about going down, you know, follow the light. Well, that could be a train coming toward me. I don't want to follow the light. Paul said to be absent from the body is to be what? Immediately present with the Lord. You know what I hope? I'm not worried of this. But I hope when I draw my last breath, the next thing I'm experiencing is the arms of Jesus Christ. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. It's the life of Jesus. You'll pass from this life. And as I've had people say to me, I had a lady one time when I worked as a volunteer chaplain at the Rhine Hospital. She said to me, she looked up and she said, help me die. And I kind of was startled by it. At first, I wasn't quite sure what she meant. At first, I thought maybe she meant, you know, doing one of those things, help her die. And I actually said to her, I said, ma'am? What? She said, I don't know how to die. I said, ma'am, just relax. Just worship. Just love Jesus. When it's time, he'll come and get you. I had a man in one of the churches I pastored said to me one day, he said, Dave, what's it like to die? I've been with people when they left this world. My mother, my grandmother, neighbors, people at the hospital, church members. My aunt, what's it like to die? And for a quick, it's one of those quick moments where you say, I don't say, excuse me, hold on a moment. Jesus, what do you want to say? And very quickly, like lightning, it came to me. I said, John, his wife's name is Vonnie. I said, when Vonnie makes dinner and it's ready, and you're sitting on your recliner, what does she say? He said to me, he yells, old man, come and get it. I kind of chuckled. I said, well, John, it's kind of like that. I said, what do you do next? He said, I get up and I go into the next room. I said, John, so it is when you die. You simply step into the next room. But instead of Vonnie being there with dinner, Jesus is there. You see, Jesus is the life. We used to sing a song, Jesus, be Jesus in me. No longer me, but thee. Resurrection power, fill me this out. Jesus, be Jesus. I started out telling you about when I was a boy. I'm going to conclude on that. When I was a boy, when I was 3 months old, my parents moved to Newport. And we lived beside the high school and junior high. And next door to us, on the other side of us, was a couple, probably about my grandparents' age, older than my parents. They never had children. We got close to them. In fact, we called them, I called them as a boy, Uncle Red and Aunt Janet. Red had worked for the phone company. Back in those days, every little area in town or something had their own phone company. Red worked for the phone company. Janet worked in the cafeteria at the high school and junior high. Red, long before we moved there, Red had been up at the cherry picker. You know what the cherry picker is? The thing they use to go up and fix the lines. And while he was up there, he fell out of the cherry picker and was instantly paralyzed from his waist down. So Uncle Red was in a wheelchair. So we drove a car, and we had the hand things. I think that would take some getting used to, because I have a feeling I would squeeze the brakes so hard everyone would fly through. But he did some things. You know, they went had stuff that they did. One of the things they did is they liked to hunt, and Red would hunt from the car. You could do that. I guess you can still do that if you're paralyzed. I don't know. It's legal.
You can.
I believe you can. But anyhow, Janet would get out of the car. She would not wander too far away. But during doe season, which is, doe season's still in December, right, Craig? Mm-hmm. I would ask someone who was able to bag a deer this year. He would know, so. So it was in December, and they went out hunting, doe hunting one morning. During the morning, late morning, a little clipper system went through, and put an inch of snow on the ground. When they came home, Janet went out, shoveled the sidewalk, shoveled the walk up to the garage. It was our backyard, the topography went up like this, and so did theirs. And I was at Cub Scouts that afternoon. I must have been about 8 or 9 years old. And I heard somebody say something about, hey, did you hear about that lady from the cafeteria? But I wasn't focused on that, because I was focused on whatever project we were doing. And I remember hearing the den mother saying, that's David's neighbor. That's David's neighbor, but I still didn't focus on it. And when I got home, my mother told me, she said, I want to tell you something. She said, this afternoon, Aunt Janet died. And I said, why? How? What happened? She said, well, she came home after she shoveled snow. She went into the house with Red. And she got sick. She had a heart attack. And she died. Later, when my dad came home, my mother said to me, we're going next door to see Uncle Red. I think he would be happy if you came along with us. I did. And I was occupied. They had a dog that was as wide as it was long, and I was kind of occupied with smoking the dog. But you know how kids are. They're occupied with stuff, but they're listening. And I heard Red tell my mother. You see, Red, they had turned their dining room into a bedroom for Red when he got hurt. And it was right off of the kitchen, and up here was the living room. I remember him saying to my mother, in my bedroom, in that one drawer, there's a box that I wrapped. It's a pocketbook. I don't know what to do with it. I bought it for Janet for Christmas. I came home. 50 years later, and it still saddens me, I said to my mother, that is so sad that Janet never got to open her gift. I said, Mom, did Janet know that Uncle Red bought her a pocketbook? She said, no. Mom, that's so sad. That's so sad. There are 7 billion people in this world, and the vast majority of them do not realize that a gift has been provided them, and it is left unopened, unrealized, and unappreciated. According to Global Ecology Global Network, take these stats for what, take them with a grain of salt and just take them. There will be 360,000 people born today in the world. That's 15,000 per hour. That's 4 per second. Will they know in their lifetime that a gift has been given to them? The gift of a Savior, the gift of a Redeemer, the gift of a life giver. There are 151,600 deaths per day. 6,316 per hour, 2.8 per second. Of those nearly 3 that die every second, how many will walk into the arms of Jesus? And how many will walk into a damnation of hell? It should change our focus. It should change our perspective. It should ignite in us a passion, and it should drive our mission. Close your eyes for a minute. Okay, Dave, you made your point. Okay, Dave, it's annoying. Okay, Dave, enough. I can stop snapping my fingers, but it doesn't stop nearly 3 people every second on this planet. From Asia to Africa, from Australia to South America, from Europe North America, from the Middle East to the Near East to the Far East, people are slipping into eternity while we sit here. There will be people that you will celebrate Christmas with that maybe they have not realized, maybe they have not opened the gift of Jesus yet. Maybe it's someone you work with. Maybe it's someone across the street. Wherever it is, across the nation and around the world, the message must be given. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ. That we pray. Will you stand with me today? I challenge you today to not let this gift go unappreciated or unopened in your own hearts and in your own lives. And I want you to think about the loved ones that have yet to open this gift. If you haven't opened this gift, if you're not where you need to be or should be with Jesus, I encourage you that in a few moments when we open these altars that you come. And we're going to ask that everyone here today, long after we leave here, tomorrow, next week, next month, even a year from now, it's my hope, not that you hear me constantly, But occasionally, when you see a second hand on the clock, you'll remember three people every second are passing into eternity. When you hear the ticking of a clock, that once in a while it'll remind you that three people have left this earth. That when you see and realize that they're passing, that one day we are mortal, we shall pass also. Be sure of your own salvation. God birthed in us a passion for Jesus. Jesus had the passion. Jesus came. He knew what his mission was. I am come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly. In Bangladesh, in Calcutta, in Jerusalem, in Damascus, in Melbourne, in Sydney, in the Philippines, in Pyongyang, in Seoul, in Tokyo, in every little village and hamlet all over the world, in Bangladesh, there are people dying, people going into eternity. One of the saddest things that I can read is when they say in an obituary or in a death announcement, Bob, Mary, Fred, Sally, passed into eternity. It leaves it so open and so unsure for me. But when I read that they passed into the arms of Jesus, it makes me to me. This is what Christmas is about. It's about three people passing into eternity every day. It is about a Savior who came so that he can ensure their path would be into the path of life eternal and not into the path of damnation. Best of Elitis, come let us adore him. And as she does, step out of the pew and come forward. Let's spend a few moments standing around these altars as a church. And let's adore the Savior who has saved us. And let's remember that we have a mission, and that's for the three every second. Will you join Beth today in singing that? Go ahead.